am Lord Krishna, I'm the chair of German studies, and I want to first give a big thank you to who made this event possible, to the Department of German Studies, but also the program of Jewish Studies, particularly Sloan Mitchell, and the Goethe Institute of Boston, which I appreciate that present. And so thank you very much for your support. And I wanted to introduce Wolfgang Fischer. He was born in 1962 in Linda, and he emphasized to me earlier in the conversation, I mean, the biographies about Feinstein, he always emphasized that he's from North Rhine-Westphalia, but he really emphasized that he's a Rhinelander, so that's quite important. And it's also important for the novel, actually. He studied German literature, philosophy, and history, and became a journalist, and then started writing crime novels in the mid-90s. And so he had already written a few crime novels when The Massive Fish came out in 2007, the first one of the Gerion Rath and Charlotte Fischer crime novels. And so that became a big success. And The Massive Fish, so originally louder. Okay, can you hear me? Okay. The original title of the book is Der Nasse Fisch, which means the wet fish, which means it's an unsolved crime. So it's a metaphor for an unsolved crime. And the English translation is Babylon Berlin. So it came after the Netflix series, and it just came out, the English translation. Are you okay? The Gerion Rath novels are 8 novels so far in total, and the last one, Marlow, is coming out at the end of this month, and it started in 1929, and it's now pushing well into the 30s, past 1933, and Volker Kutscher is projecting that he might go up to 1938 as a definitive point. The books have been translated into many, many languages, into 17 languages, and you might be familiar with the series that just came out, which premiered in Germany last year on the Sky TV channel, and then on Netflix here in the US in January. And now, actually, just about a week ago, was the German public premiere on the public TV, and it was accompanied by marathon screenings in 150 German cinemas with people dressing up in 1920s wear and having a currywurst as a snack during the break. And so it was a big event. There's also a comic adaptation of the novel that came out last year. So for someone working on the Weimar Republic, it's actually really such a pleasure to read this work, and it's so lovingly researched in the historical details, and Volker Kutscher really creates a whole universe that pays homage to the iconic literature, art, and music of the time, but still feels really fresh in the way the characters are shaped and in the way they interact. There are many differences to the TV series, and we might get to that towards the end of the discussion. It's definitely a lot less drugs and a lot more history, I would say. And there are some significant other differences that I think are important for the interpretation. We just had earlier a conversation with some of the students who are taking the Weimar Republic class, and Volker Kutscher talked about how important the iconic art of the time was to him in creating this universe, particularly the novel Berlin Alexanderplatz from 1929, the novels The Artificial Silk Girl, the novels Fabian, so novels that really recreate the city, create the city of Berlin through the lens of a particular character who walked through the city, experienced the city, and this feel really becomes alive also in these novels. He also has talked about how important it is to him to capture also the German-Jewish experience of the time and the impact discussions on anti-Semitism had in the 1920s. And of course, this links us also to the particular moment we're undergoing today in thinking about Weimar, and that's why thinking about Weimar also becomes important. We have a wonderful coincidence today insofar as the daughter of the owner of the nightclub, Mocha FD, is actually in the audience. And so if you've seen the series, the Mocha FD plays a huge role in the series. In the novel, the first novel itself, it's one of the many clubs. There's a whole like spectrum of clubs in the novel, which is really beautiful. In the series, the Mocha FD is it. So maybe we'll have a chance to hear a little bit more about this. But I'll pass on now to Volker Kutscher. We'll have the reading in German. We will have English projections. And then we'll have discussion afterwards. So please help me welcome Volker Kutscher.
Thank you very much, and good evening. First I will start a little reading, about 20 minutes, and it's just the beginning of the novel, and it's also nearly the beginning of the TV series, but also there are little differences. Maybe you find out if you have seen the first episode of the TV series, and I just will start, for I don't want to waste any time, because I think the most important thing is to talk afterwards. So it's chapter 2 of my novel. Der Mann erinnerte ein wenig an Wilhelm II. Der markante Schnurrbart, der stechende Blick. Wie auf dem Porträt, das zu Kaiserszeiten in der Stube eines jeden guten Deutschen hing und in manch einer immer noch nicht abgehängt war, obwohl der Kaiser vor über 10 Jahren schon abgedankt hatte und seitdem in Holland Tulpen züchtete. Der gleiche Schnurrbart, die gleichen Blitzeaugen. Doch da endeten auch die Gemeinsamkeiten. Dieser Kaiser trug keine Pickelhaube. Die hing zusammen mit Säbel und Uniform über dem Bettpfosten. Dieser Mann trug nichts außer dem nach oben gezwirbelten Schnurrbart und einer imposanten Erektion. Vor ihm kniete eine nicht minder nackte Frau, gesegnet mit üppigen Rundungen, die dem kaiserlichen Zepter offensichtlich den gebotenen Respekt entgegenzubringen gedachte. Rat blätterte lustlos in den Fotos, deren eigentlicher Zweck es war, Lust zu erregen. Weitere Aufnahmen zeigten den kaiserlichen Doppelgänger und seine Gespielin bereits in Aktion. Und ganz gleich, wie sich ihre Körper verknoteten, der markante Schnurrbart war immer im Bild. Schweinkram! Rath blickte sich um, ein Schupo hatte ihm über die Schulter geschaut. So ein Schweinkram, fuhr der blaue Kopf schüttelnd fort. Das ist Majestätsbeleidigung, dafür hätte es früher Zuchthaus gegeben. Ja, aber so beleidigt sieht unser Kaiser doch gar nicht aus, meinte Rath. Er klappte die Mappe mit den Fotos zu und schob sie zurück auf den wackeligen Schreibtisch, den sie ihm zur Verfügung gestellt hatten. Böser Blick unter dem Tschako. Der Mann in der blauen Uniform drehte wortlos ab und ging zu seinen Kollegen. 8 Uniformierte standen im Raum und unterhielten sich halblaut. Die meisten wärmten ihre Hände an einer Kaffeetasse. Rath schaute zu ihnen hinüber. Er wusste, dass die Schupos im 220. Revier gerade andere Sorgen hatten, als einem Kriminalbeamten vom Alex freundlichste Unterstützung zu gewähren. In 3 Tagen wurde es ernst. Mittwoch war der 1. Mai und Polizeipräsident Zörgiebel hatte alle Mai-Demonstrationen in Berlin untersagt. Die Kommunisten aber wollten trotz des Verbots marschieren. Die Polizei war nervös. Gerüchte über einen geplanten Putsch machten die Runde. Die Bolschewisten wollten Revolution spielen, Sowjetdeutschland mit 10 Jahren Verspätung doch noch errichten. Und im 220. Revier war die Polizei nervöser als in den meisten anderen Berliner Bezirken. Neukölln war ein Arbeiterviertel. Noch guter war höchstens der Wedding. Die Schupos tuschelten. Ab und an warf ein Blauer dem Kriminalkommissar einen verstohlenen Blick zu. Rat klopfte eine Overstolz aus der Schachtel und zündete sie an. Dass er hier ungefähr so willkommen war wie die Heilsarmee in einem Nachtclub, das braucht ihm niemand zu sagen, das war offensichtlich. Das Sittendezernat genoss in Polizeikreisen keinen allzu guten Ruf. Bis vor 2 Jahren noch war es vorrangige Aufgabe der Inspektion gewesen, die Prostitution in der Stadt zu überwachen, eine Art verbeamtete Zuhälterei also, denn nur polizeilich registrierte Prostituierte betrieben ihr Gewerbe legal. Viele Beamte hatten diese Abhängigkeit schamlos ausgenutzt, bis ein neues Gesetz zur Bekämpfung der Geschlechtskrankheiten diese Aufgaben von der Sittenpolizei auf die Gesundheitsämter verlagert hatte. Seitdem kümmerte sich die Inspektion um illegale Nachtclubs, um Zuhälter und Pornografie. Ihr Ruf allerdings hatte sich kaum gebessert. Immer noch schien etwas von dem Schmutz, mit dem sich die Beamten beruflich zu beschäftigen hatten, an ihnen hängen zu bleiben. Rath blies den Zigarettenrauch über den Schreibtisch. Von den Chakos an den Garderobenhaken tropfte Regenwasser auf den Linoleumboden. Grünes Linoleum, wie es auch in den Büros der Kriminalpolizei am Alexanderplatz verlegt war. Sein grauer Hut wirkte zwischen all dem schwarzen Lack und den glitzernden Polizeisternen wie ein Fremdkörper. Ebenso sein Mantel, der mitten im Blau der Schupo-Mäntel hing. Ein Zivilist unter lauter Uniformierten. Der Kaffee in der verbeulten Emailtasse, den sie ihm hingestellt hatten, schmeckte scheußlich. Widerliche schwarze Brühe. Auch im 220. Revier konnte die Polizei also keinen Kaffee kochen. Warum sollte das in Neukölln anders sein als am Alex? Dennoch nahm er einen weiteren Schluck. Etwas anderes hatte er nicht zu tun. Nur deswegen saß er hier, um zu warten. Warten auf ein Telefonklingeln. Er griff noch einmal zu der Mappe auf dem Schreibtisch. Die Blätter, auf denen Doppelgänger der Hohenzollern und anderer preußischer Prominenz in eindeutigen Positionen abgelichtet waren, gehörten nicht zu der üblichen Billigware. Kein Druck, sondern hochwertige Fotoabzüge in bester Qualität, wohlgeordnet in einer Mappe. Wer so etwas kaufte, musste schon ein paar Mark hinlegen. Das war etwas für die besseren Kreise. Am Bahnhof Alexanderplatz hatte ein fliegender Zeitschriftenhändler die Blätter vertrieben, nur wenige Schritte vom Polizeipräsidium und den Büros der Inspektion entfernt. Der Mann war der Streife nur deshalb aufgefallen, weil er die Nerven verloren hatte. Die beiden Schupos hatten den Händler auf eine harmlose Illustrierte aufmerksam machen wollen, die ihm aus dem Bauchladen gefallen war. Doch als sie sich näherten, hat er ihnen sein komplettes Sortiment entgegengeschleudert und die Beine in die Hand genommen. Zusammen mit den Zeitschriften waren den jungen Schupus auch die pornografischen Hochglanzfotos um die roten Ohren geflattert. Ihre Bewunderung für die Kunstfertigkeiten der Fotomodelle hätte sie beinahe vergessen lassen, dem flüchtigen Händler nachzusetzen. Und als sie endlich die Verfolgung aufnahmen, war der Mann im Chaos der Baustellen rund um den Alex verschwunden. Das brachte den beiden Schupus kurz darauf im Präsidium den zweiten Satz rote Ohren ein, als sie ihren Fund auf Lankes Schreibtisch ablieferten. Der Chef der Inspektion konnte sehr laut werden. Kriminalrat Werner Lanke vertrat die Auffassung, dass Freundlichkeit seiner Autorität schaden könnte. Rath musste daran denken, wie sein neuer Chef ihn vor 4 Wochen begrüßt hatte. »Ich weiß, dass Sie gute Beziehungen haben, Rath«, hatte Lanke ihn angeschnauzt. »Doch wenn Sie denken, Sie müssen sich deswegen nicht schmutzig machen, dann haben Sie sich geschnitten. Hier wird niemand geschont. Ein Mann, um den ich nicht gebeten habe, schon gar nicht.« Seinen ersten Monat in der Inspektion hatte Rath nun fast hinter sich. Die Zeit war ihm vorgekommen wie eine Strafe und vielleicht war es das ja auch. Obwohl sie ihn nicht degradiert hatten, nur versetzt. Er hatte Köln verlassen müssen und auch die Mordkommission. Aber er war immer noch Kriminalkommissar. Und er hatte nicht vor, ewig bei der Sitte rumzuhängen. Er verstand nicht, wie der Onkel das aushielt, aber dem Kollegen schien die Arbeit für die sogar Spaß zu machen. Oberkommissar Bruno Wolter. Wegen seiner gemütlichen Art, von den meisten Kollegen Onkel genannt, leitete ihre Ermittlungsgruppe und auch die heutige Razzia. Draußen im Hof des Polizeireviers stand der Mannschaftswagen. Wolter besprach dort mit den beiden Damen von der weiblichen Kriminalpolizei und dem Bereitschaftsführer die Einzelheiten der geplanten Aktion. Jeden Moment konnte es losgehen. Sie warteten nur auf Jänikes Anruf. Rath stellte sich vor, wie der Frischling in der muffigen Wohnung saß, die sie für die Observierung des Ateliers beschlagnahmt hatten, in einer Hand das Fernglas, während die andere nervös über dem Telefonhörer zitterte. Auch Kriminalassistent Stefan Jänicke war erst Anfang April zur Sitte gekommen, ganz frisch von der Eiche gefallen, wie Wolter ihn manchmal aufzog. Denn Jänicke war direkt von der Polizeischule Eiche zum Dienst am Alex beordert worden. Doch der blonde, wortkarge Ostpreuße ließ sich von den Frotzeleien der älteren Kollegen nicht beirren. Er nahm seinen Beruf ernst. Das Telefon auf dem Schreibtisch klingelte. Rath drückte die Zigarette aus und griff nach dem schwarzglänzenden Hörer. Der Mannschaftswagen hielt direkt vor einer großen Mietskaserne in der Hermannstraße. Misstrauisch schauten die Passanten zu, wie die jungen Uniformierten von der Pritsche sprangen. Polizei war in diesem Teil der Stadt nicht gern gesehen. Im Halbdunkel des Torbogens, der zu den Hinterhöfen führte, wartete Jänicke. Die Hände in die Manteltaschen gegraben, den Kragen hochgeschlagen und die Hutkrempe in die Stirn gezogen. Rath musste ein Lachen unterdrücken. Jänicke gab sich die größte Mühe, wie ein abgebrühter Großstadtbulle auszusehen. Doch die ewig roten Wangen verrieten den Jungen vom Lande. »Da müssen jetzt ungefähr ein Dutzend Leute drin sein«, sagte der Frischling und versuchte mit Rath und Wolter Schritt zu halten. »Ich habe einen Hindenburg gesehen, einen Bismarck, einen Moltke, Wilhelm I, Wilhelm II und sogar einen alten Fritz.« »Na, ich hoffe auch ein paar Mädels«, sagte der Onkel und steuerte den zweiten Hof an. Die beiden Damen lächelten säuerlich. Die Zivilbeamten und 10 Uniformierte folgten dem Oberkommissar zum zweiten Hinterhaus. Auf dem Hof spielten 5 Jungen mit einer Blechdose Fußball. Als sie das Polizeiaufgebot sahen, blieben sie stehen und ließen die Dose eine letzte scheppernde Pirouette drehen. Wolter legte den Zeigefinger an die Lippen. Der Älteste, er mochte vielleicht 11 Jahre zählen, nickte stumm. Oben wurde ein Fenster zugeschlagen. Fotoatelier Johann König, 4. Etage, verkündete ein Messingschild am Treppenaufgang. Der Onkel hatte einen seiner zahlreichen Informanten bemühen müssen, um König auf die Spur zu kommen, denn der Fotograf war ein unbeschriebenes Blatt, polizeilich gesehen. Er fertigte preiswerte Passfotos für die wenig zahlungskräftige Neuköllner Kundschaft an, ab und an auch die obligatorischen Familienfotos. Säuglinge auf Eisbärenfell, Kinder mit Schultüten, Hochzeitspaare und was die Kundschaft sonst so wünschte. Als Schmutzfink war er noch nicht in Erscheinung getreten. Keine Vorstrafen. Aber einen Eintrag gab es doch. Einen politischen. Man musste nicht straffällig werden, um der Polizei aufzufallen. Rath hatte die Idee gehabt, auch die umfangreiche Kartei der Abteilung 1a der politischen Polizei zu durchforsten und war auf eine Notiz gestoßen, die dort seit 10 Jahren schlummerte. 1919 hatten die politischen Johann König als Anarchisten registriert und ihm eine eigene, wenn auch nur spärlich beschriftete Karteikarte gewidmet. Nach den Revolutionszeiten war der Fotograf politisch nicht mehr aufgefallen. Er hatte sich wieder ins Private zurückgezogen, wie so viele. Aber jetzt hatte ihn seine offensichtliche Abneigung gegen Preußens Glanz und Gloria doch noch in Schwierigkeiten mit dem Gesetz gebracht. Kein Wunder, dachte Rath. Mit so einem Nachnamen gegen die Monarchie zu sein, das kann einfach nicht gut gehen. Einem jungen Bereitschaftspolizisten schienen ähnliche Gedanken durch den Kopf zu gehen. Der Kaiser bumst beim König, witzelte er und schaute nervös, grinsend in die Runde. Niemand lachte. Wolter postierte den Witzbold vor dem Eingang Mit dem Rest der Truppe stiegen sie so leise wie möglich das schummrige Treppenhaus empor, in das nur wenig Tageslicht fiel. Irgendwo im Haus dudelte ein Radio Schlagermusik. Im zweiten Stock öffnete sich eine Tür, ein grauhaariges Mütterchen streckte ihre Nase ins Treppenhaus und zog sie ganz schnell wieder zurück, als sie das Polizeiaufgebot sah. Zwei Frauen und 12 Männer, die kaum einen Laut machten. Ganz oben, vor der letzten Tür, blieben sie stehen. Johann König, Fotograf, stand dort angeschlagen, diesmal allerdings nicht in Messing graviert, sondern auf ein vergilbtes Pappschild gedruckt, das sich bereits wellte. Wolter sagte nichts, sah nur kurz den Bereitschaftsführer an und führte den erhobenen rechten Zeigefinger an die Lippen. Nur das Radio war noch zu hören und von der Straße her ein weit entferntes Autohupen. Ein kräftiger Tritt hätte gereicht, um die klapprige Tür in den Raum fliegen zu lassen, doch Wolter schob den Bereitschaftsführer beiseite. Rat sah, wie der Onkel einen Dietrich aus der Manteltasche zog und sich am Schloss zu schaffen machte. Er brauchte keine 5 Sekunden, um es zu öffnen. Bevor er die Tür aufstieß, zog Wolter seine Dienstwaffe. Die anderen taten es ihm gleich. Nur Rat ließ seine Mauser stecken. Nach dem Zwischenfall in Köln hatte er sich geschworen, keine Waffe mehr anzurühren, wenn es irgendwie zu vermeiden war. Er ließ den bewaffneten Kollegen den Vortritt und blieb draußen an der Tür stehen. Von dort beobachtete er die absurde Szene, die sich im Atelier abspielte. Kaum hatten die Polizisten den großen Raum betreten. Auf einem grünen Kanapee mühte sich gerade ein muskulöser Hindenburg auf einer Nackten ab, die entfernt an Mata Hari erinnerte. Daneben stand ein einfacher, uniformierter Lanzer mit Pickelhaube. Ob er sich als Nächster mit Mata Hari vergnügen durfte oder seinem Generalfeldmarschall noch sexuell zu Diensten sein musste, war nicht ersichtlich. Die übrigen Darsteller, die Hälfte davon nackt, betrachteten die mit mehreren Scheinwerfern ausgeleuchtete Szene und unterhielten sich angeregt. Ein Mann mit Ziegenbart hockte hinter einem Fotoapparat und gab dem Generalfeldmarschall Befehle. »Dreh Sophies Hintern ein bisschen mehr zu mir. Noch etwas. Ja, so geht's. Stillhalten. Und jawohl.« Und wieder hatte er eine Aufnahme im Kasten. Wunderbar. Alles Beweismaterial. Niemand in der illustren Runde hatte bemerkt, dass gut ein Dutzend Polizisten mit gezogenen Pistolen das Atelier betreten hatte. Die jungen Bereitschaftspolizisten verrenkten sich die Hälse, um genug sehen zu können, und schoben weiter in den Raum. Es schepperte, als ein Scheinwerfer in dem Gedränge zu Boden ging. Die Gespräche verstummten. Alle Gesichter drehten sich zur Tür, die Mienen gefroren im selben Moment. Nur Hindenburg und Mata Hari ließen sich nicht aus dem Rhythmus bringen. »Aushebung, Polizei!« rief Wolter in den Raum. »Alles kommt mit zum Präsidium. Gegenwehr ist zwecklos. Lasst besser alles stecken, wo es steckt, vor allem, wenn es wie eine Waffe aussehen sollte.« Nun schauten auch Hindenburg und Mata Hari auf. Niemand kam auf die Idee, sich zu wehren. Einige Hände gingen in die Höhe, andere schoben sich reflexartig vor Geschlechtsteile. Alle 4 Frauen im Atelier waren kaum oder gar nicht bekleidet. Die Beamtinnen warfen ihnen Wolldecken über die Blöße. Und dann traten die Uniformierten in Aktion. Die ersten Handschellen klickten. König faselte irgendetwas von Erotik und Freiheit der Kunst, verstummte aber, als Wolter ihn anschnauzte. Und dann war die Prominenz dran. Bismarck, Klick. Fredericus Rex, Klick. Der alte Fritz hatte tatsächlich Tränen in den Augen, als man ihm die Eisen anlegte. Alle wurden sie der Reihe nach verpackt. Hindenburg und Mata Hari musste man vom Kanapee holen. Die Jungs von der Bereitschaft hatten leichtes Spiel und ihren Spaß. Rat hatte genug gesehen und ging zurück ins Treppenhaus. Keine Gefahr mehr, dass einer entwischte. Er stand am Geländer und schaute in die Tiefe. Dankeschön.
All right. So maybe we should sit.
Ich zieh mal um.
Cool. Great. So I'm going to open it up right away and see if you have any questions. I have plenty, but I think I'd like to take some from the audience. Yes, David.
I was just wondering how much you participated in the adaptation and what difficulties that presented to you, since it seems as though the rhythm of the text is so much slower than the rhythm of the adaptation, the cinematic.
So the question is about his involvement in the adaptation, and that the rhythm of the adaptation is a lot slower, a lot faster than the rhythm of the mm-hmm. text.
I wasn't involved, really involved, you know, but the three directors, they told me everything they did. So they showed me the screenplay and anything, but I didn't write and didn't do anything. I just had to do my own project, you know. My project are the novels, and I have to write two or three more. And back then, I had to write four or five more. So I concentrated on my work, and I told them, "Okay, do what you want. Tell the story like you have to tell it, but stick to my the essence of my novel." And you know, I didn't know back then that it would be 12 hours of TV series, and my novel is about 500 pages. And so, this is very, very free adaptation, because I added many plots, subplots, and just things in my novel. There are backstories, for example, Schwarze Reichswehr, Black Reichswehr. There's a smuggling of arms and guns, and you know, it's all for the Schwarze Reichswehr, the novel, but in the TV series there's a whole storyline about Schwarze Reichswehr, and the same with the Russian gold smuggling. It's just a backstory. It all happened already in my novel, but they tell the whole story in the series, and many, many more like this. And and it's kind of different, but at the end it tells the same story about people who lived back then, who didn't know what was going to happen only 3.5 years later.
Yes, Klaus?
Veronica mentioned at the beginning already that probably the Weimar Republic is one of the most densely fictionalized periods in German history. And I guess for a lot of these writers, studying like some of us, forgive me, it must have been very, very difficult to keep that relation between historical fact on the one hand and the fiction on the other. Was that an option for you, even one step further from a contemporary perspective, doing this kind of fictionalization of history, compared to all these authors who already were there?
Yeah.
I'll just quickly repeat the question for the. So the question is really about the tension between fiction and history, which already was an issue in the Weimar Republic itself. In some of the novels, and in some ways becomes more of an issue in a contemporary look at the Weimar Republic.
It is very important for me to tell my stories from the perspective of the people who lived back then and who didn't know what was going to happen. And on the other side, it's very important for me to entertain and to tell crime or detective stories, so that maybe some people will read it who wouldn't have read it otherwise. My crime stories are completely fiction, but the background, mostly of the background, it's authentic. So like the Mocha Efti in the novel, it's a real Mocha Efti. It's not in the TV series. The TV series is more about the feeling of the time, you know. Not, but For me, it was important the facts had to be right, and in these facts, my fictional story is embedded. Maybe I don't know if it's the right word, but it's in it, and it has to be possible that a story like this could have happened back then. That's important to me.
Yeah, I have a question about the translation that you see on the screen. I mean, David's questions have asked about how in the TV series the novel somehow gets streamlined and a lot of detail gets lost. But it's even true here that certain phrases or sometimes even certain sentences from the German aren't included in the translation. I don't know if this is from the novel, just for today. But it's been curtailed. And one of the things I like so much about the books is the depth of the historical detail and the things that don't pertain to the plot necessarily. Mm-hmm. Or at least you don't know it first. And it seems that this is sort of clipped.
Yeah, so the question is about the English translation, that it seems that it has been curtailed or clipped and that some of the historical depth of the novel is not coming through in the translation.
First, I like the translation. I think it's a good translation, but I don't know, my English maybe is not the best to say that and to judge this, but yes, I know it's a little bit shorter than my original, and sometimes when I do reading, I also shorten my text, but I didn't here because I want to show, read all of it, you know, and so you can compare what translation is and in the original is. Yeah, but I think the most important thing is that this thing is going, the people have to read it also in the UK and in the US, and when the publisher says, okay, it's a little bit too long, and I shorten it a little bit, it's not that so much. It's a few, maybe at the end, maybe 10 or 20 pages, not more. But there's a sentence missing, and there's also, so like this, he did it, but there's not a whole scene missing or something like this. It's a whole story, and he just shortened it a little bit to be, yeah, a little bit more tempo in it. It's a little bit faster than my my novel. I take my time to tell my story, and it's a little bit faster, not as fast as a TV series, but a little bit faster.
I guess for us literary scholars, 10 or 20 pages is quite dramatic already.
You know, I was working at a newspaper, so it's nothing.
Oh, right.
500 pages, 20 genre. Pages is nothing.
Right. Well, we have a question here. Petra?
Yeah, thank you. So I'm still struck by the fact that you're still writing novels, and and the series has, of course, taken off in very, very impressive ways. And so it's a thing now to watch Babylon Berlin. There's a cult, there's a hype. I wonder, is there really no feedback in terms of how well can you close yourself off from that? And does it really not enter your writing at all or your thoughts? I'm just thinking of examples, might be fitting or not, but I was just thinking about Dickens. And when he wrote his novels and they became incredibly popular, there was feedback, and it did influence his writing, and he enjoyed the intimate relationship that he had with his readers, and the fact that he did get readers' reactions and factored them in. So I just really wonder, you know, because the phenomenon is so massive, how well can you really keep it at bay?
So the question is about the phenomenon of Babylon Berlin and the hype around around the series, and how there's maybe a feedback into your work, and how you position yourself towards that.
You know, the TV series doesn't interfere my writing, but the feedback had become a lot more. But the direct feedback with my readers is just a thing like this. Maybe there are some more people than before, but not always. In Germany, I had my audience just before the TV series, and so it didn't change so much things. It, so. I enjoy to read just a new novel, to read it in front of an audience and get some feedback and to hear what the people think about it and so on. And that's not different. Maybe it will happen, I don't know. But I think I have the same things in my head than I had before. It's the same world. My Babylon and Berlin is another world, and then the TV Babylon and Berlin, it's another world, and the graphic novel Babylon Berlin. I wasn't so sure as it began, but it's like this, and I'm very glad that I don't have to fight against foreign images, you know. I have my images still in my head, and it's my characters, and because they are a little different. In the TV series, they are different, little different in the graphic novel, but it's still in my head, as my world of Babylon Berlin, and so I will go on and write the next novels, and maybe when I'm finished, maybe I take part in a little screen, but I don't know. First I have to do my work, and then I can do other things.
So you still have your very own Charlotte Ritter in your
it's
head.
My Charlie. Yeah,
your Charlie.
You know, I call her Charlie, and in the TV series it's never called Charlie, only Lotte.
In the series, yeah.
But in my world, Charlie was Lotte as she was a young girl. And I did it's a longer short story. It's a small book I did with the German illustrator Kat Menschik, and she made wonderful pictures of Charlotte. It's a story. It takes place in 1927, just 2 years before the first novel. And there, her father and mother are calling her Lotte, but in this novel she becomes Charlie because she's grown up then, and the grown up Lotte, Charlotte is Charlie. So this is very important to me. It's just a completely different Charlie than the Lotte, Charlotte in the TV series. But Liv-Lisa Fries, the actor, she looks a lot like this is Charlie in my head, actually. Yeah.
Thank you, Lee. I have a question about the sources that you used while researching for this, because it struck me that it's quite interesting, your emphasis on writing from the vantage point of the protagonist who didn't know all the history that's yet to come. And that could be a challenge, having all these history books right from you, because they draw this trajectory for you. So what are your sources when you're writing, thinking of plot about newspapers from the time? Do you consult history books? Do you must consult photos?
Yeah, so this is a question about the sources for your work, and also in some ways about the position, right, of the protagonists who don't know yet what is to come, what we actually know. So,
I use any source I can find. I started with the novels, with Döblin, with Erich Kästner, with Emrah Cohen and so on, Hans Falada. There were many novels at this time, and I read them again and with a notebook, and I wrote down all the things, all the reality in these novels. That was the first step, just before. Then there was, in Berlin, there's a Polizeihistorische Sammlung. This is a museum of the police works since, I don't know, 19th century. And I read a lot, and photos and films and newspapers. This is, I think, the most important source is the daily newspapers. And always when I am going to start a new novel, and I know my story is set maybe in 5 or 6 weeks, and I know in which time concretely it is set, I grab the newspapers. Not everyone, mostly. Vossische Zeitung, Berliner Tageblatt, some liberal newspapers, and I read every page and every, not only the big politics, but the local events too, and the joke and everything, to get a feeling for the time and for the people in this time, and even for the prices, what a car will cost, or a hat, or you know, because, and I also have from Aschinger, old menu, to know what a glass of beer costs or a cup of coffee, and this is just you become you get nearer to the I don't know how to say yeah, you get in touch with the time. It's the best way to use a newspaper to do this. It's the best time machine to me. And yeah, and about the perspective, that's the second part of your question. Yes, I know what happened in 1933, and most of us, I think, I hope, know this, and so I can work with this, because in Germany everyone knows. Not exactly what in detail happened, but everybody knows 1933. Adolf Hitler came to power, Third Reich, it started all then in this year. And my characters, they don't know. So I can play with it. It's like Hitchcock does. You know, the audience knows more than the protagonists in a story. And I don't have to show a bomb or whatever in a car because my people know there is a bomb, there's something going to happen. My characters don't know, and I like to play with it. And I hope maybe it helps to drag you as a reader in this world, and you. Become friend with my characters, and you share their hopes and everything, because they don't think of Nazis as their leaders. They imagine it just completely just a different future. And what I hope is that you maybe get familiar with this world, 1929, 1930, 1931, and then I hope you. That you are shocked when you realize 1933. Oh, the Nazis are in power, and that's what I'm playing with.
Yes.
I guess my question is connected to that. Of late, I think there have been some crime novels. I'm thinking about Penny Marquez, mm-hmm. Crime series where he uses entertainment by entertaining this readership with political education. Right? He's talking, for example, about Sweden's immigration crisis, xenophobia, racism. And I'm just wondering, since the Weimar Republic was such a time of political upheaval, again, does your novel also take in some way a political stance? Do you ever write this also to educate the reader, educate young people who might read that, and how do you negotiate entertaining your reader and maybe translating a political message, if at all?
So this question asks what kind of political stance these crime novels takes and puts it in relationship, for example, to the Wallander novels in that regard.
Yeah, my novels, they have no message, not this and this, not like, I'm no teacher, and I'm no history teacher, too. The things which happen in my book are not explained. There are normal for the people who live there, and if you as a reader you want to know more about it, you don't find everything in my book. You have to search it by yourself, and that's the same with the message, you know. Of course I think there is a message, but not a simple message. I don't know, as a writer I have to say, if there were it's a simple message. My message is other novels I wrote down. Not you can't, I don't know, condense some message the whole story. You have to read it to not to find a message in it. How should I explain? Okay, maybe like this. One reason for me to write the novels is that. I always ask myself, how could this happen? How could 1933, how could the Nazi, how could history in Germany happen like this? Why did the Weimar Republic fail? Why did the Nazis fall or not, maybe the Kaiser or something else, I don't know. And in history, there are many answers. It's all explained and stole. But for me, there was always a question that was remaining, the question, why? But okay, it's, you told me everything about workers' movements, they were divided and not together, but still, why? And that is one important reason to write these novels, to not to find an answer, but you can't find a simple answer to this, you can maybe you come more nearer and nearer to an answer. That's what I try, and it's just an experiment. I have my characters, very different characters. I throw them into this time, and they have to deal with it. They have to react, and I don't know exactly what will happen to them. Not before I start to write the stories, and I see what happens to them. Maybe this is the same thing when you read it, and don't do it as a teacher and say, "Hey, Nazis are bad." I hope most people know that Nazis are bad, but more important is the Nazis weren't fallen from sky. They were not ordinary people became Nazis, and this is something I want to explain too. It was your neighbor, and suddenly he was a Nazi. Maybe he was before, but this is a normal world. It became such an awful world where everything was upside down suddenly, and what was good was bad, and this I want to show. And I hope if you, yeah, it's maybe this is a thing fiction can do what science can't. Empathy. Yeah. To look into other people's heads. I do this as a writer, and you do this as a reader, and this is what it's all about. It is not a teacher, hey, I have to teach you something. So it's not the way I write my books. Okay.
We had Heidi and then Klaus.
All of my questions were already answered, but I have another question for you. So with the crime fiction, because this is Germany's favorite genre, crime fiction, detective novels, especially like the series, Kommissar Brunetti and Der Alte. So how do you see yourself in all this genre? And also, how many novels can be awaited with your lad? Or is the one that is coming out in November really the last one? Or can we wait for more?
So the question is about how you position yourself in regard within the kind of German universe of crime fiction, which is a pretty storied one and very popular one, thinking of Tatort. And then the follow-up question is, where will you stop? I mean, how can you push this into the Third Reich what happens there?
I really don't know where my position is, and I think I'm not the one to answer this question, but it's for you to do this. You know, what I'm, as a reader or as a, I know what I like. It's not only German Krimi, it's many American stories. I great admirer here, James Ellroy, for example, as a classic Chandler and Hamlet and so on. But where I am standing, all this, I don't know. That's for you to say. But Gary Rath, this I can't answer, because my first plan was to go to 1936, the Olympic Games in Berlin, and then stop the series, because then I would have told four stories in the Republic and four stories in the Third Reich, and I thought this was very symmetric and okay. But then I realized 1936 is a year I can't stop the series, because it's just too positive year in the Nazi, because of the Olympic Games. It was a propaganda show, and everything was okay, and Berlin is a great city and so on, but it wasn't. But so I decided to stop and end the series in 1938 with the so-called Reichskristallnacht, the pogrom nights in November then. And so also my next novel, Marlowe, it takes place in 1935. And so I have to write two or three more, I don't know exactly, you know, first novel after novel. I don't know where it all will go, because I'm not John K. Rowling. I have no end of my rat stories in a safe anywhere. I don't know. I just I take my characters as I come out of the last novel, and I put them into the next, and see what happens.
As we were talking about before, the characters have their own life also, right?
Yeah, they have. Yeah. But it's not as easy as you think, that they are, you know, stands behind me and says, okay, you have to write following. And I said, okay, thank you. It's just, it's more like this. You write 30 pages and then tip. Huh? This is all rubbish. Throw it away. Make it again. That's not me. So it works like this, you know.
I see.
Yeah. It's not always easy with
that's
him.
Not easy.
Yeah, no.
We had Klaus and Gerd. Did you have another follow-up? Yeah. Klaus and then in the back.
Yeah. I would like to come back to your previous answer that fiction can do something that a scholar of text usually cannot do. Because a scholar of text, in a way, always only calls into explanations, either historical or political or whatever kind of an explanation they give for historical facts. Whereas the novel can, of course, play the characters, include the characters sort of times through. And I have to admit that I have not had the chance to read one of the novels, but I saw the entire series. And what I noticed there through the characters is that in one way or the other, they all are in a way opportunistic. And I was wondering whether that has something to do with the time that made these people already appear opportunistic. I mean, not in a way is opportunistic, because whenever it becomes political, he says, well, you know, I'm just a policeman and I'm just a detective. The younger system, they're all in one way or the other trying to bail out from any kind of political things or try to maneuver themselves through. Is that also in the novel, and was it on purpose to explain this kind of, to give it some kind of local historical color, or is it just my perception?
Okay, so the question is about how fiction in some ways can transport a different kind of truth than history or scholarly engagements with history can, and how this relates to the role of opportunism, thinking about opportunism in the setting of the Weimar Republic as a opportunism, yes, as a comment, political comment.
Yeah. I must disagree with you, because not every character is an opportunist not even in the TV series. Some Georg Rat is, of course. That's by on purpose, because I wanted him like this. What you said, politics, oh no, go away with this. I don't care. But a guy like Bruno Walter, he's very political. He's working with the Schwarze Reichswehr, and so this is a political statement, of course, and many others have too. But in my novels, a little bit more, something like Charlotte, for example, she's very, she's democratic, she's a democratic Prussian, they all often fight, Gerion and Charlotte. In my novels, there are a couple much more. Series, they are not, everybody knows, okay, they are, have to be, but they aren't till the end. But in my novel, they are, but they fight a lot and they argue and so on. And it's mostly about politics, their fights. So she has a point too. She's not no opportunist. And Ernst Gennert, more important in my novels than in the TV series, he's also no opportunist. But it's a real problem, I think. In times like this back then, maybe today, it is a very big problem. The people who are indifferent, who don't care, say, oh, I don't care politics, I have to live my life and nothing else interests me. This is a problem in a democracy, because we have the state is we are all and this is, we have to realize this, that this, it depends on us what we do or what we not do, and indifference is the wrong attitude. So I hope that some of the recent events in Europe and in the US, right-wing populism, is maybe a kind of wake-up call to show us how important our way of life is, and that it's not unbreakable. You know, it's many people fought for it and died for it, so that we could live our life like we do, for our freedom and everything, and justice, and what else, and freedom of speech, and you know what everything what is important, and these things are endangered now, and we learn, okay, it's maybe you have to fight for it.
We had a question here in the back. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say, like you said, 1933 didn't sort of appear out of nothing. There was certain tangible events that led up to that. And for me, what was really interesting was learning about sort of like the training of German fighter pilots in Lipetsk, and the Schwarze Reiser, and sort of other sort of more insidious movements that for me, I grew up in Austria, that weren't very well documented there. And I guess the question is, for you, how much of this was a lesson in history to perhaps movements like what was happening in Lipetsk, and generally when formulating the ideas for these novels, how much did you learn about the socio-political context of Germany in the 1920s, when you had this fragile democratic order that was the Weimar Republic?
Yeah, so the question was about the fragility of democracy and the socio-political context of it. You said you grew up in Austria, right?
Yeah, Austria, sort of like how much, I mean, I think the series documents sort of the Russian training base in Lipetsk, and how much that was sort of a well-known method, I guess.
So how the series documents the Russian training base in Pets, and how that's reflected in... Because I don't think
that's... No, it's not in the novel.
Right, exactly.
Actually, it's not in the novel, because all the Schwarze Reiswehr story is just... in my book, it's only, you know, Bruno Walter, he does his things for the Schwarze Reiswehr, but it's not explained. That was what I meant before. I don't explain everything, and so I don't explain Schwarze Reiswehr and what that is. But this was... This is historical. There was in the Soviet Union, there was a two parias of European after World War II. One were Russia and Germany,
right.
And so they helped each other out. and the Reichswehr trained the Luftwaffe, the Air Force in Russia. That was true. Yeah. But I didn't understand everything of the question,
but I think there were more. It was about the training base, which doesn't really play a role in the novel.
So,
But
the question was also about how much he learned in the process of doing the research.
Okay.
I learned
very much by doing the research, of course, and sometimes I was surprised. Mostly little details, but mostly about how modern these times were, and I didn't know it before. And I try to put this into the novels, into my fiction, but it's not always possible. You know, you can only do a little, so much of research put into your story, and you have. But if you would do everything, put everything in your story, maybe it's not worth reading because it's too big. And so I sometimes I can't do, and I hope maybe in the next novel. But I always I'm always glad when I find something what surprises me, and when I could put it in the novel, I think maybe it surprises the reader. The reader thinks, oh, no, that's not possible. That wasn't back then. There was no, I don't know, hairdryer, Haartrockner,
electrical
hairdryer. There's, in the first novel, there's a murder by throwing a hairdryer into the bathtub. It's just for us. It's not very modern, but back then it was a very new kind to kill someone, and so things like this, or what's called Rolltreppe?
The escalator.
Escalator, yes. I didn't know that back in the 20s there were escalators already, and or what we call in Germany Disco-Kugel, these mirror balls. We call them Disco-Kugel because I think we just saw that were in the 70s, were invented in the 70s, but in the 20s there were also these balls and same effects, like if many years later. Or what I didn't know was that Mickey Mouse and Walt Disney was very popular in Berlin in 1931. And you can see this in the movie Fritz Lang, when the murderer goes with the girl in this candy shop, and there's a Mickey Mouse as a advertising thing, and so such things I use.
Yeah, and this leads maybe to a follow-up. We haven't talked really about the cinema of the time, which I think when we talk about Berlin Alexanderplatz, it's a novel that has been called a filmic novel, right? Because it uses and reflects the medium film, and in some ways your writing really does also engage with the film of the time, and you've cited that as major influences also. I mean, Mabuse.
Yeah, yeah, I think, so, yeah,
right.
Dr. M.
That's the obvious one.
Yeah, yeah. There are some, yes, and the second novel is about film business.
Right.
It's about silent movies and talking movies. But how big the influence is, I really don't know. But I know it all starts with two movies. But at first there was the movie from Sam Mendes, Road to Perdition.
Mm-hmm.
I watched it in, I don't know, 16 years ago, maybe. I think it's 16 years. Yeah, and shortly after I watched Fritz Lang, this M movie, and I realized, okay, this both movies are play in the year 1931. And one in Berlin,
mm-hmm.
and one in Chicago and around Chicago, and one is a gangster movies. Both are gangster movies. And so, my first idea was to connect these two worlds: this American gangster world of the 30s and the Alfred Döblin world of the 30s. It was just the first idea, and then after that, I thought, okay, I have to do a series, and I have to do a series about. From 1929 to 1936 or 1938 to pass the year 1933, because it is a big cut in history, but also there were continuities. Life was going on also after January 1933, and so I wanted to show both, and I wanted to show also these two worlds, American gangster world and Berlin world, and it, I think in my third novel in
Goldstein.
There's a Jewish American gangster, Abraham Goldstein, who comes to Berlin where his father was born, and there he meets some SA guys who want to beat up an old Jew, and he interferes.
He turns around the tables.
Yes, he does.
Right. This is kind of redeeming.
Yeah.
A little bit. We have maybe time for one more question, or two. All right, two. Irene and Kristen, and then we'll close.
I wanted to go back to sources and inspirations a little bit, and you mentioned Lean, and you mentioned Yamagata Koen, and Kesna, and I was very curious
So the question is about Gertrud Kolmar's novel, Eine jüdische Mutter, A Jewish Mother.
No, I didn't. Maybe I should. Okay.
What strikes me so much about it, and then she didn't try to publish it, even though there were not yet restrictions on Jewish writers. And what's, to me, very haunting about that novel is not just the horrible crimes, so that's, there's the rape of a five-year-old child that goes unsolved, but the very profound anti-Semitism and misogyny that's in the novel. And I can't help but conclude that she not only felt that and therefore was able to write a novel about it, but then she realized the atmosphere in Germany was already so dangerous that she couldn't try to publish such a novel at the time. And it didn't come out until well after her death. She got the manuscript to her sister in Switzerland, publishes it in 65, and she herself is murdered in Auschwitz in 43. But it's a very moving kind of evidence of what was going on in the late Weimar Republic. So I was just curious if it...
I'm not going to do justice to you to your rendition, but this is basically about how anti-Semitism and misogyny conflate in this novel and are presented in this novel, and that Kolmar captures something about the Weimar Republic that is even seen as too explosive to be published at that very time. But Kristen, you had a last question.
Yeah, just a quick question. I had a question about the names of the characters, because I just watched some of it recently, and I thought a really funny line when they introduce each other, Lotte and Gerion, that she asked, do you come from the Middle Ages?
Yeah.
And so I thought, like, did you purposefully choose, like, how did you come about naming these various characters, like Koenig, for instance?
So this is a question about the names of the characters and how you chose them.
Yeah, Gerion is a name. It's in Cologne. You know this name because it's a saint. There are two churches in Cologne named after Saint Gerion, and I was looking for a Cologne name because I wanted Gerion Rath should be an alien in Berlin. And you should see it at the name. In my novel, they always mix it up. They say Gero or Gideon or something. And in the last novel, some woman asked me, is this a Jewish name? And I said, no, it's a Catholic name. But nobody knows this name in Berlin. So always people ask, Gerion? And, I was on search for such a name. There's another very Colonian name. It's Severin, but it's the name of his brother. And Anno is always some saint of in Cologne. Is his brother who is dead in the war, and his father is called Engelbert, which is also a bishop in Cologne in the, I don't know, 13th century. So they all have Cologne names. His sister is called Ursula, the Heilige Ursula. It's also all Cologne, Catholic Cologne names.
So it's a regional positioning.
Regional positioning, yeah. He's a Rhinelander. He comes from
the
Rhine.
That's right, against Rhineland. A kind of Berlin-Prussian world.
Yes, he's a Rhine-Prussian, a Rhine-Preußer. Because, you know, Rhineland was Prussian since 1850. 15. So about 120 years. Rhineland was Catholic and Prussia was
Protestant.
Yeah. And so it doesn't fit so well, but after more than 100 years, it fits a little bit more. Yeah.
So we've kind of come full circle to the beginning. And please help me thank Volker Kutscher for the reading.
Yeah. Thank you.